an event entirely run by volunteers, members of the Graduate Astronomy Student Association at UNC, which is why you got a feedback form on your way in. We're always very interested to see how you can improve these events even more, make them even better for our audience. Obviously, you may not have brought a pen with you to this event, maybe not prepared to take notes quite to the rigor that I might in this room, but we'll have pencils up at the front of the room at the end of the talk, as well as cookies if you forget the feedback form. We'll give you a cookie. As usual, we're going to have planetarium shows after the talk. If you signed up online, you'll have had instructions of what to do, but I'll reiterate those at the end of the talk. If you didn't have a chance to sign up for a planetarium show, there will be tickets available outside of this lecture hall right after the talk finishes. So keep an eye out for those, and I'll give more instructions on how to pick those up at the end of the talk as well. A few more announcements coming up. We will have a regular July tour, as usual, the first Thursday of every month. But our August tour will be replaced with a special event at the end of July, where we'll have guest Shelley Ray talk about new ways that we can communicate with extraterrestrial life. So there's been an announcement slide up here. That's July 22nd, which is Saturday. We'll be having that special event with Professor Shelley Ray at the dinner. There's a lot of announcements for me today, so I'd like to get to the talk, which is what you're all here for. Tonight we're joined by Yvette Sundas. She's a visitor to the department studying radio astronomy, but tonight she's here to specifically tell us about supernova 1987A and its life and times. So let's welcome Yvette.
About the life and times of supernova 1987A. To tell you, so we all start on the same page, a supernova is basically a very massive star at the end of its life when it explodes in a fiery explosion, which is the biggest explosion that we really know of out there. This specific supernova is a very special supernova. I'm going to tell you guys why this is a special supernova, and it's called 1987A. Because it went off in the year 1987, that's when its light reached Earth. And it's A because it was the first supernova seen in the year 1987. It's a very, you know, rigorous naming process here. So with that, let's get started. So to start off, where we're going to start off is night sky. If you were to get out of a city and look up, you can see the Milky Way overhead. This, to be fair, is not exactly like the Milky Way you would see if you just went outside of Toronto for a few hours. This is the Southern Hemisphere Milky Way, which is a little bit different from ours for a few reasons. But the big reason is there's these two fuzzy things here. So this here is the main Milky Way galaxy. This is the plane of our galaxy. And these two things here are the Large and Small Magellanic Clouds. So these are satellite galaxies of our own Milky Way. The Large Magellanic Cloud is about 10% the size of the Milky Way in terms of the mass and things like that. The Small Magellanic Cloud is a little bit smaller than that. They're about 170,000 light years away from us. And basically they're orbiting the Milky Way. They're sort of like fluffs of lint is how you can think of them that are orbiting. And so yeah, if you go out in the Southern Hemisphere and you look up, you see the Milky Way, and even to your naked eye, you'll say, oh, there's two other fuzzy things sort of over, you know, in that direction. The other interesting thing that I wanted to say about this picture that a lot of you might not realize is when you go out and you look up and see the stars at night, even, you know, just a few stars you'll see in the city of Toronto, all of these stars that you see, for the most part, with one or two exceptions, are actually really, really big stars. So what do I mean by big? So when we go into the world of stellar sizes, if you're looking at this chart, up here there's the sun. And then these are all sort of typical stars that you might see in the night sky, which are some of the brighter stars even that you see. So Sirius here, for example, is the brightest star in the sky. It's usually in the winter sky, it's pretty high up. It's the brightest because even though it's, quote, only 8 times the size of the sun, it's also less than 10 years, light years away from us. When we say light year, that means the amount of distance it takes light, which is the fastest thing that there is to travel 1 year. Then we have some other stars that you can see that are even more massive and more massive, and things like that. So as you can see, there's basically, when a star is bigger, it's brighter, right? This makes sense. And that light can then travel further distances. It doesn't fade away as quickly. It should be said also that most of the stars are actually not supermassive stars like this. They're actually very small little red stars. You can't even see any to your naked eye when you're looking out at the stars that there are out there. And so the interesting thing though, so we have these clouds, they're called supermassive stars. They make up about 1% of all the stars that there are in the galaxy. And so supermassive stars, they're sort of like the rock stars in astronomy, because they basically burn really bright, and they live really fast, and they die in very, very energetic explosions. With that, let's get going here. So the life cycle of a star, the way it really goes, so you start out, you have a stellar cloud, which is called a nebula, and this is basically a giant hydrogen gas environment. And you start getting basically clumpiness in this gas. This gas clumps together, you know, I'm accelerating in a few seconds through several million years at minimum. But then you're going to basically start getting a fusion happens when hydrogen combines into helium. That's what makes stars shine. And so most stars, as I said, you know, 99% of stars out there are going to go this track up here. So you're going to have, like, so our sun, for example, is on this track. You're going to start, you're going to have a small star. When it starts running out of fuel, it's going to start poofing out. This layer is actually going to come out for our sun, for example, in about 4 billion years out to our Earth's orbit. So it's going to poof out quite a bit. And then eventually, it's going to, when it runs out of fuel in the center, it's going to just sort of shed out its layers in what's called a planetary nebula, which is this beautiful thing here. It's going to leave behind in its center a white dwarf, which is about the size of Earth. So it's just like this very glowing ember is sort of how you can think of it. So, okay, most stars are going to do that kind of thing at the end of their life. The supermassive stars do something different. When you have a large star, it's actually so burning its fuel very fast. So a star like our sun takes about 10 billion years in its entire cycle, billion with a B. These are on the millions of years range. So it's going to run out of its fuel. It's going to swell up as well into a supergiant. And then what's going to happen, though, it's so massive that you're going to have what's called a supernova event. And when a supernova happens, it's basically the stellar core collapses, and it gives off this giant explosion, and you have two things that can be left at the end of it. So this is stars that are the size, they're about 8 times the size of the sun. That's like the general ballpark where you start getting, for example, what are called neutron stars. This is when you have a giant ball of neutrons start packed together very, very tightly. So it's about the size of Earth. It orbits even as fast as, you know, several in 1 second. So this is just a very fast spinning thing, and you can get radio signals and X-ray signals and things like that from that. Or if it's a very, very massive star, so about 18 solar masses are up, that's a general ballpark, you get a black hole. I'm sure everybody's heard about black holes. These are basically when you get something where light cannot escape it, there's so much mass in such a small space. And so as I was saying, neutron stars, to give you a general idea when I'm saying they're really small, they're the size of a city. This is Vancouver here, if there was a neutron star next to it, to give you an idea. This is basically a stellar mass of material packed into the city, you know, the size of Toronto, the size of Vancouver. And I'm emphasizing this point, so we're going to come back to it later in our talk. So anyway, so as you know, we have supernova. They're very exciting, very interesting, and so, you know, we like explosions in astronomy. So we're going to look at, you know, we have seen supernova in the past, so I wanted to tell you about this. They do happen, but they're very, very rare. To give you an idea of how rare, there's a few in history that we have seen. And like the fact that I'm starting in 1000 AD sort of tells you how often we see these, right? But so the, one of the most famous supernova that there's out there is in 1054 AD, there was what the Chinese astronomers recorded as a guest star in the sky. And it was also recorded by Japanese and Iraqi astronomers, and there were also the European record, there were some chronicles where, and then there was a star in the sky during someone's reign, like that kind of stuff happened. And even in the American Southwest, this is in Chaco Canyon, there's a pictograph. This is, they think it could be this supernova, because they figured out when the super would have gone off. It would have been in the springtime of 1054. This would be the crescent moon here. This is a hand for scale, and some people say this could potentially be the supernova. Why is everybody so excited that, oh, there's just a new star in the sky? Supernova, when they go off in something like our galaxy, you can see it, they are incredibly, incredibly bright. This was so bright that you could see it during the day for several months. You could read by it at night, was what they said. And it was in the sky for 2 years after it first went off. To give you an idea, I mean, this was obviously a very big event. And the interesting thing, though, is, yes? Yeah, so we'll get into how it goes. And go, yes, that's it. I mean, there's no advanced warning system. Well, you know, especially in 1000 AD, there was just one day there was a guest star. That's what they called it. They had no other word for it. So anyway, so because we have these records, we can go back and be like, okay, this is the area of the sky this happened. Let's go back and see, is there anything there today? And it turns out when you do that, you have something that's called the Crab Nebula, which is one of the brightest things in the sky at a lot of different frequencies. The left side here is an X-ray, so like X-rays when you go to the doctor, those X-ray frequencies. On the right is visible light. And so what you're seeing here is this is a nebula, so gas, around this, this is what's in the center is a pulsar, so one of those neutron stars. You can literally see, even though it's it's about 6,000 light years away, you can still see that there's, you know, it's putting energy into its environment, and you know, this is, as I said, it's a very active object that we study. So, okay, we found out, you know, proof of concept. Another sort of famous historical supernova, it's called Kepler's supernova, which was in 1604 AD. And so Kepler, by the way, he wasn't the first person to discover this supernova, but he wrote a very influential book at the time because he was the court astronomer in Prague. So everybody read the book and then they called it up, named it after Kepler. So, you know, that's how sometimes science goes. In 1604, Galileo also observed it and made some very crude scientific predictions about like how far away he thought it was and things like that. So, you know, this was a very well-observed thing. This one was so bright, by the way, that it was visible in the day for several weeks as well. And it was at night for up to 18 months. And when you go in the direction that it was, so this is Kepler in Kepler's book. Down here, this is where there's the new star. And if you look in the sky, you now see this supernova remnant there. So the reason this is also a very important supernova, the reason I'm telling you about this, is this is the last supernova that we observed with as it was going off until the one I'm going to tell you about. So 1604 AD. That was obviously one, that was before the invention of the telescope, to give you perspective on how long ago this was. And I mean, you know, they didn't even know, like, the Earth going around the sun is still a novel concept at the time and things like that. So why is it, like, how rare are these, if I'm saying the last one was the 1600 that we saw in our galaxy? So this is our night sky picture that we were looking at. And even in our galaxy, as I said, these supermassive stars, they're very rare, very few go supernova. Statistically, in a galaxy of our sun, which has 100 billion stars in it, you get about one supernova per century. So they're not exactly very common. You'd have to wait a long time to write your PhD thesis if you were going to wait for a supernova in our own galaxy. But you would say, okay, but the last one was 1600s. What happened? Why have we been waiting, you know, since then to see one? We have telescopes. This would be really cool, right? So the answer is, though, that if you look here in this picture, you see there's a lot of dust in our Milky Way, right? So because there's this dust, if a supernova went off, you know, since we have, you know, before various frequencies that we can look at that aren't optical light, you wouldn't see it, right? It could go off, and if it's obscured by dust, you'd just be like, oh, okay, well, we didn't see it. And that's sort of the end of the story. So that's unfortunate, and you know, a supernova are very important events. We want to see if we can learn about them. And so luckily, though, 30 years ago, we did kind of get a chance to study one a little bit closer. So as I said, these are the satellite galaxies of the Milky Way. We're going to focus on this one here, the Large Magellanic Cloud. As I said, it's 170,000 light years away from us. And it's a very interesting part of the sky to study because of this thing here. This is called the Tarantula Nebula. So as I said, this is a little bit of lint of a galaxy, and it's orbiting us. And because it's orbiting the Milky Way, it's a subject to what are called tidal forces. So it's tides, or, you know, like what causes the tides on Earth. Similar gravitational pulls, and it's basically from the small galaxy orbiting our big galaxy. And what happens is, you know, you have dust clouds there too, but they get more friction in them and stuff like that. So you have this very active star-forming region, which is the biggest that we know of in our local universe that we can study. When I say active from one side of this picture to the other, that's 1,000 light years, to give you an idea. It's a very, very big, very active area in the sky for star forming. What this means is you also have a lot of very, very massive stars there. And by what I mean by this is, well, like, if you're an astronomer and you're really interested in massive stars, most of the ones that have been discovered are actually here, because you don't have to deal with the gas. You know, this is a very active star-forming region. So, and also we have a very clear line of sight to it. So these are all really good reasons if you want to study supermassive stars. A lot of interesting stuff happens in this nebula. And one of the things, of course, for supermassive stars is you also can, hopefully, if you're very lucky, see a supernova. So, supernova 1987A. So, on the night of February 23rd, 1987, an astronomer named Ian Shelton, who is at the University of Toronto affiliated, and he's still at the university today, he was at Las Campanas Observatory in Chile. And he was having a rough night, and he was basically having trouble with a telescope, and around 4 a.m. he's like, okay, this night is done. I'm gonna go develop my photographic plates. So in 1987, it was a different era than today. You had these giant glass plates, you had to go to the dark room, you had to develop them, and then you saw what you had. And when Ian was there, he basically had noticed on one of his plates, there was suddenly a really bright star there that wasn't there the night before. Like, he had literally the other plate, and he was looking at it and stuff like that. He's like, wow, this is weird. This is so bright, if I go outside, I should be able to see. Goes outside, looks up, it's like, oh, there's literally a new star. Realizes this must be a supernova event going on. Checks with another astronomer who's up at the observatory. He's like, yeah, like, that's, you know, we should report this. They try to figure out how to report it, because, you know, this is the 80s, we don't have the internet yet, it's not that obvious how to do this. The radio satellite phone didn't work, so they then had to drive 100 kilometers to a village and send a telegram. So but this was very lucky that, you know, he developed the place that night, because several other astronomers later looked, and they could have been the ones who discovered it, but they didn't send out the telegram first, so. So yeah, always do your work, be productive, guys. You know, that's what they always talk about. And so to give you an idea of what the supernova event would look like, this is a before and after picture of that field of the sky. You got the before here, and then you have the after. And you could go out, it wasn't for several months as I'm describing, because this is much further away, but you could go out for, I think it was a few weeks or so, and see a supernova with your own eyes for the first time in almost 400 years. So, that's pretty exciting. It was also pretty exciting, by the way. So while I was researching this talk, I was going around YouTube, as one does when giving a talk, and I realized that there was a really nice documentary made by NOVA in 1988 called The Death of a Star. And it was so 80s-tastic that I had to show you guys a little bit of it. So as I also said, Ian Shelton, he's here, he's from Toronto. I see him back there, actually. And, so, definitely look this up on YouTube. It's actually all scientifically correct. It's just, you know, from that era. So we're going to watch just a little clip of it, because I think it's pretty fun.
Tonight on the supernova, a star blows itself apart in the most violent event in the universe.
This is a great thing. You circle all your life, really, that you're going to get to see something like this.
I missed out a little bit.
I remember walking around for about a week, and everyone I've seen.
Astronomers the world over scrambled to uncover the mystery behind the death of a star.
Anyway, so it's wonderful. And this is fun because this was at the University of Toronto when they brought me
the supernova has touched the life of every scientist who has studied, none more than its discoverer, Ian Shelton. Some home, he told his story to his colleagues and to his family.
Las Campanas being the wonderful place it is, I always wanted to be there, and I'm glad I had the opportunity to get down there. The first time, thanks to Bob taking a chance, and I guess 2 years ago, he took another chance on me and let me go back for a return engagement, I guess. And I guess I did do it.
First time ever. There was one other thing that happened with the supernova that's really important I want to share with you, and it was the discovery for the first time from outside of our solar system of a weird little particle called neutrinos. So neutrinos are fundamental particles. They're like electrons or protons, you know, any of these fundamental particles you've ever studied, like, but they are kind of weird. And so there's so little mass in them that for a while people literally thought that they're maybe just massless, that they have no mass whatsoever. They can pass through everything, like they don't really interact with their environments very much, like they pass through the Earth all the time, this is a big thing. And so there's also just a lot of neutrinos out there. So this is an interactive talk. I want everybody to put out their finger like this, pointed upward. So every single second that your fingertip is pointed upward like this, there are 100,000 neutrinos streaming through your fingertip. So when I say there's a lot out there. Most of them come from the sun. And as I said, they don't really hurt you. I mean, you've lived your entire life with neutrinos streaming through you, and you probably were unaware of it until this very second. So, I mean, they don't hurt us. They're there, and they are created in various astrophysical properties that happen. But they're really, really, really hard to detect, as I said. And so, but it turns out in a supernova, you emit a lot of these as the neutron star gets formed during that collapse that I was talking about. So a supernova is estimated to give off 10 to the 58th neutrinos when the neutron star is created. I was trying to figure out a way to correctly describe how many 10 to the 58th is. And I think we figured out it's 10,000 times the number of atoms in the sun. So, like, a lot of neutrinos. And to give you an idea of how difficult they are to detect, before this point, there have been no neutrinos detected from outside the solar system. They'd only detected ones from the sun. And during this event, three observatories around the world, around pretty much at the same time, discovered 25 neutrinos out of the 10 to the 58th that were streaming out of this star at the time. But this was really, really, really exciting because this was, as I said, the first time that they'd actually detected neutrinos from anything. And, you know, they can now detect a bit more now, but it's still a pretty hard thing. Give an idea. So neutrinos, because they don't really interact with much, you basically have, they're called bubble chambers, and it's sort of like water, and you're looking for light, very faint flashes of light that these give off as they interact, streaming through and all this stuff. But, so this is the observatory that detected some of those first neutrinos. And to give you an idea of perspective, so this is like, there's water here. This here is a boat. There's two people in that boat. So that's what they used to detect the first neutrinos. The other one I did want to mention is apparently at the time there were very, very crude gravitational wave detectors, so like what LIGO is, but they were all turned off because they were all at a conference that week, is what I heard. So neutrinos happened. That was really exciting. A lot of cool things going on with this supernova. So what actually happened, you know, like, okay, there's a new light, what did it happen? So basically what went off is that there's this very bright flash of light, and there's some gas in that environment. You know, it's a very gassy environment. If you saw that picture I was telling you about, there's also the star, they think in the tens of thousands of years before it died, it was giving off poofs of gas. They're not, the supermassive stars give off large poofs of gas before they die. And so when the supernova went off, it basically lit up the gas around it, and it's sort of like a light echo type thing. I think in the simulation, the purple were like the neutrinos streaming out, is sort of the idea here. The point is that I want to say is, you see, like, this gas was already there, and suddenly it's being lit up. And also there's, the second thing is, you know, we're going to talk, there's going to be the shock waves going out, and how is this material interacting? So Hubble was not yet launched in 1987, but once it was, of course, they pointed at it to see what they could see. This here in the center is the supernova, and here's the close-up of what they saw. And so, you know, you have these rings, and so this is what I was telling you about. There's this gas there, and basically got lit up by the supernova explosion. And to give you an idea, so these rings, if you look, they're not perfectly symmetrical as we see them. And that's because you have sort of a strange topology going on here. You have sort of the central ring here, which is going to be important, we're going to talk about this a bit. And then you have these two outer rings that make up these outer rings here. And so this is sort of what supernova 1987A looks like today, or looked like, you know, once they could go and see some details in it. And then there's the question of, okay, but like what happens over time? So when you're observing, what you basically have is, in astronomy, you know, where stars live a long time, we do not really live that long time. The fact that this went off 30 years ago is actually really exciting, though, because we could sort of study how this thing has evolved at very actively at any stage of its life. So to give you an idea, like, what do astronomers do? You're studying the supernova remnant. This is me in 1987. And so you look at that picture and you look at me and you're like, okay, so she was really small and she got really big. She was a little cuter then, you know, stuff like that. So what happened? Like, how did she evolve as a life form? If you were an alien anthropologist, you would want to study and learn and how exactly do humans grow? So that's sort of what we want to do. We want to study how does the supernova remnant grow? And so one of the things you can study, for example, is how much light is coming out of this. So this here is the days since the outburst of the supernova. And this here is how bright it is, basically. And you can see, like, it peaks really high at the start, and then it's been fading as the dust forms and stuff like that. I forgot to mention, so if you see these blue dots here, somebody is going to ask me, does that mean they studied it before day zero in the supernova? And yes, so you had, as I said, a lot of astronomers who had photographic plates. And after the fact, people went back, and some people saw this rise, basically, on their plates. And, I mean, there's several astronomers out there who kicked themselves that they didn't develop their plates. They could have discovered the supernova, but they didn't. Mm-hmm. That's science, sometimes. Anyway, so this is the main supernova, and it's fading, fading, fading. And around here, we start seeing what's the ring emission. And so what do I mean by the ring emission? There was that inner ring, and it basically started glowing as this supernova shockwave travels thousands of kilometers per second outward and starts interacting with the material that's there. And so studying what's going on in this environment is a very interesting thing. There's a lot of weird stuff going on. And one of the ways astronomers study is, so if you were to only ever look at one little part of the spectrum, so we have this thing called the electromagnetic spectrum, goes from gamma rays to radio waves. So radio waves, like what you listen on your radio, that's like at the very low end of the spectrum, goes all the way to that gamma rays. And each part of the spectrum is like a different piece to the puzzle of what is going on in any environment in astronomy. And so there's a lot of different telescopes here. We don't have time to talk about all of them. But really briefly, we're going to talk about radio quite a bit because that's what I do, so obviously it's the best. There are the ones down here, so you can do that on the ground. Some telescopes, so like Hubble is somewhere here. There's going to be a 3D printed model of Hubble. You can check out later if you want. Hubble is above the atmosphere because the atmosphere has wiggles a lot in light. And then there's X-ray as well. Okay, that's X-ray actually. But so this is Chandra. It's an X-ray telescope that was launched in the mid-90s or so. And you have to study X-ray astronomy. You have to launch satellites because very lucky for us, the atmosphere does not allow X-rays to come through. So with that, you know, we have these different pieces of the puzzle. I do radio myself. And so what does this mean? Like, what does the sky look like if you have radio eyes? So as I said, this is the Milky Way that I've been showing you guys all night, as we know it. But if you have radio eyes, this is what the sky would look like. So obviously it looks very different. What are we looking at here? Most of these little dots that you see are galaxies. They're called radio galaxies. Far, far away, they'll have active black holes in the center that basically spew off a lot of radiation. And that's what we see far, far away. But then you can also see, like here, for example, there's kind of like these wispy things. And those are basically leftover from supernova remnants that went off, you know, thousands or even millions of years ago in our galaxy. So you can study, you know, as I said, some of these remnants, or you can see them in the radio. So what do I do in this context for, you know, studying supernova 1987A? There's a radio telescope in Australia called ATCA, which is the Australia Telescope Compact Array. This is a picture of it here on the left. So these are individual dishes. And this here is a railroad track, and you can move the dishes up and down depending on what kind of configuration you want for different kinds of observations. It's better to use some over others type stuff. And so what you can do is over time, you can look at how is this ring evolved. As I said, it started showing up as a ring. We're going to see more ring stuff, don't worry, just to give you an idea. This is sort of what radio observations look like, and you can see some structure in this ring. How does it evolve, things like that. And we've had continuous observations since 1992. And since 1992, the thing is, everybody's always kind of shocked when I say this, but in radio, like, there's actually usually more data out there than there are people to look at it. And so I became affiliated with this group because they had data from 2013 nobody had looked at what has been going on with this supernova. And I was like, oh, that sounds actually really cool. So I came and I've been working on this. So what has been going on in the past few years with Supernova 1987A in the ACADEV? And so it's been an interesting project. And I'm going to just tell you guys what I've been doing here and stuff like that. But I will say, this is kind of a little side segment. People always ask you if you're an astronomer, why are you an astronomer? Like, this is a bit of a life calling type of discipline rather than a normal career. I have two. The first is I like stories, and astronomy is the biggest story I can think of. And, well, you guys can tell I like to tell stories. But the second is I also think it's just so, so cool that when you know something in the universe that nobody else really knows, like, you know, it's just like a very exciting feeling to me. And the reason I'm saying all this is because my new images, I've actually not shown it to anybody except for the few people who are like helping me with my slides and stuff like that. So you guys are also going to be in the club of what's going on with Supernova 1987A. This isn't published yet, so you know, don't call the New York Times or anything, but yeah. So what has been going on? This is from my actual data. So they said a lot of these are radio observations this team has been taking for years. And what you're seeing here is basically this ring of gas that's there, and it's the electrons in the gas get excited by the magnetic fields as this shockwave is basically traveling through this gas ring. So if you're looking at the beginning, it's really, really faint. It's still really compact. You don't really see that much. But over, you know, 2.5 decades, it's growing, there's some gaps in the observation that's just for various, you know, observing issues, and I just sort of chose one image a year so you can sort of see what's going on here with Supernova 1987A. So yeah, it's getting brighter, it's expanding, it's behaving as it should. So to give you a close-up here of what's been going on since, this is the most recent image was taken in February of this year, the data and when it was processed. You can see, so this ring is no longer like a perfect ring of gas or anything like that, right? There's some clumpiness going on, like here it's starting to fade, it's a bit brighter here on this side and this side. So there is also kind of the question of how does the clumpiness work in this? How exactly is this shockwave interacting with the environment as it's going through at its thousands of kilometers an hour? So as I said, astronomy, a lot of it is finding different pieces of the puzzle and fitting them all together to figure out what the story is. So there's a lot of data. The Hubble Space Telescope looks regularly in the optical band to see what this supernova remnant looks like. And Chandra is an X-ray telescope. And I said it didn't launch until later than here, so that's why there's nothing there yet. And then ATCO is the radio. And so this only goes until 2003. I didn't find the equivalent that's like for more data. But it does give you an idea that if you're looking in the visible light, you can definitely see like the clumpiness. How does the clumpiness of the ring look as gas has been dealing with the shockwave going through? X-ray light tells you when there's gas that's excited and starts glowing. That's basically what you're seeing in the X-ray. So the shockwave is kind of setting off this gas and it's getting brighter, stuff like that. And then the radio, as I said, it's electrons and magnetic fields and stuff like that. So it really tells you a lot about how this shockwave is evolving and things like that. So sort of what's going on. All right, so you can see this is a plot from the most recent X-ray paper that they published. So what you're seeing here is these curves, this curve, and this curve here in the blue, the X-ray, this at the time, the little blue, the black crosses down here, that's the radio data. You see it was not published until, 2013, that's what the record ends. So you're kind of filling this in, even taking it further than what's currently published. But what you can see here, which is very interesting, is the X-ray data is definitely leveling off here, right? It's no longer getting brighter in the X-ray. The Hubble data shows the same thing. Like this thing is starting, the shockwave is passing through this gaseous ring of the supernova remnant. And now it's the question of, okay, like we're clearly entering a different phase, what's going on? So I can tell you right now, the radio has not, it's still brightening, but it's not like leveling off at any crazy degrees or anything like that. But there are models right now that we expect this inner ring to be completely destroyed and probably really on the fade out by 2025 is kind of the initial estimate. So, which by the way, like, this is really, really exciting in astronomy that you can study something on a few year time scale when normally things happen in millions or even billions of year time scales. Like, this is a very exciting supernova event because, as I said, they're so rare. We can study this in such detail in such a short time scale, what exactly is going on in these environments. That's pretty cool. But there's still some questions. that remain with supernova 1987. This isn't just like the fade out and, you know, anything like that. The big question we still have that we're trying to answer is, what's at the center? So if you remember when I told you stars die in supernova, there's two options. You either get a neutron star or you get a black hole. As of today, nothing has been detected at the center of supernova 1987A, which is a bit of an interesting mystery because, well, yeah, something happened. So we do know, to be fair, neutrinos were released and we observed them. So a neutron star was created. There's always the neutron star could then collapse further into a black hole. As I said, it depends on how massive the star was and things like that. We're not actually sure of how massive the star was before it exploded because it was sort of a dime a dozen star in this area of the sky, so we don't really know. We think it probably is a neutron star. We don't think it was massive enough to become a black hole. But so what we would normally do is you can get pulsar emissions, so basically like little bleeps several times a second and then the pulsar is spinning pointed toward Earth. That's something you can see from pulsars, but if it's a really dense environment, if the magnetic field is weird, if it's just not pointed toward you, you're out of luck. You're not going to see something the size of a city in optical light 170,000 light years away. No matter what, James Webb, you're not going to see it either, folks. Like, you know, this is really, really difficult. So what you can do, though, is there's something called a pulsar wing nebula. So when I was showing you the Crab Nebula sort of bubbling earlier in the X-ray and the optical, that is a really good example, really nearby, of a pulsar wing nebula to Earth. So what basically happens there is the neutron star is putting energy into this really gassy environment that's left over after the supernova has exploded. And so what you basically have then is you start seeing this gas sort of interact. Like this is it's called the Ghost's Hand Nebula, I think it was. So this is in the X-ray data. And so this is, quote, only 17,000 light years away. And because it's 17,000 light years away, you can see, like, okay, there's some detail there. Can we maybe see, it's been 30 years, there's been, you know, some energy going into that environment, the neutron star in the center maybe creating its own little pulsar wind nebula. So this is kind of what I'm going to be doing in the next few months of my own research. I can't tell you the answer. I don't know yet myself. But the idea there is the ring right now is really bright, but if you're really confident in what the model of that looks like, you can maybe subtract it out of your image and leave behind what's called a residual. And then in the residuals, if you saw something at the center, we do think that this telescope, theoretically, it should have the capability of seeing a pulsar wind nebula by this point if you could subtract out the other bright stuff basically around it. So that would be really cool, really exciting, and you know that would be one of my first person to know if there was actually a neutron star created. Cross our fingers, but that's what an astronomer does, I guess. So, well, thanks a lot for talking to me, and you know, just sort of the takeaway messages here. It's been 30 years. Supernova 1987 is really going into a new phase of its life. It's been a really exciting ride. We've learned a ton about supernova remnants studying this object. And hopefully, you know, radio observations, we're going to learn still more about how this shockwave is evolving and stuff like that. But also, you know, there's still mysteries. Like, we don't know what's in the center of the supernova. Hopefully, we'll find this out sooner or later. And yeah, thanks a lot for your time.
Let's get some good questions for Yvette. Yes?
When you first showed the two slides of the supernova 1987A, you were talking about the gentleman who found it, and he looked at the plate, and you showed the two slides side by side. It was really little small, and then the next one was, you know, from my point of view, the size of the breakthrough, I'm sure it was bigger than that. What's the time lapse between those two?
So I'm not sure. That's not like the literally those two plates. Like those, I think, are just black and white. But he had the plate from the night before when he was looking. And so even just because that's the best caliber you can have, like the exact same field the night before. So that's what he was looking at, but that was something there's a bright star. So. And the reason it looks so big is it was just oversaturated.
Right.
So.
Okay.
In general, people can move that supernova like that might turn into a black hole.
So as I said, it really depends on the mass of the star. Most supernovae do not have black holes that end up at the end because basically the more massive the star is, the more rare it is. So I think it's something like 10% or 1 to 10%, you know, astronomy, that's like nothing, turn into a black hole.
in Nobuse?
Yeah, so there's actually been several things. One of the ones that's really important is, so Supernova, I didn't really get into this, but they fuse a lot of elements in there, in the supermassive star before it dies, and Supernova kind of like ejected out. So there's been a lot of questions, how does this process happen? So how does the supernova then seed other stuff around it? So there's been a lot of questions answered about that. The other one that's interesting is, so as I said, all stars become supergiants before they die. And there's different kinds of supergiants. There's a red supergiant. Everybody thought in 1987 that that was the only kind of supergiant that could go supernova. This was a blue supergiant. So that was actually a bit of a surprise. And that's one of the reasons, you know, it was just a dime a dozen star and he was actually consuming it, because it wasn't expected at the time to go off. And I think the details of how blue supergiants explode are still not fully understood.
How big can supernovas get?
As in, like, how wide, or?
Yeah.
So, I mean, the sky's the limit, I guess, in some ways. But usually what happens, so this will be, like, you know, thousands of, as I said, it's traveling at thousands of kilometers a second. So the sort of loops that I was showing you that were left over, those could be, like, you know, tens of light years across, even. Yeah.
Also, you, like, said what happened to the giants and, like, super giants, but there's another type of star called a hypergiant. What happens to those?
Hypergiant. Oh, a hypergiant? Those also go in supernova eventually. The thing about hypergiants, I think they do a lot of mass loss, like releasing their gas. So they're kind of interesting beasts. So I don't study the stars as much before they explode, so I'm not.
I was thinking about predicting the next one. Like, so all the data that's been collected since 1987, has it made it easier to possibly predict when the next one might come?
That's a great question. The answer is, one of the biggest unsolved questions in physics, and you will get a Nobel Prize if you can predict this supernova is about to explode like next week. You will definitely get the Nobel Prize. The trick is, so I mean, we can tell, like, some stars you can see out of the sky, like Betelgeuse, which is the shoulder star for Orion, that's kind of reddish. That is definitely at this supergiant phase. It's definitely nearing the end of its life. Is it going to go off tomorrow night or in, you know, tens of thousands of years? Third, we don't have the capability right now to say to that precision when a star is going to explode. It's actually a very competitive field. It's a lot of computer simulations and fluid dynamics, basically, to figure out when supernova are going to explode. And if you're like in the two leading groups and you get a job in the other group, they don't let you take your computers out with you. It's like really, really hard.
What was going on during that very brief warm-up period where the unlucky astronomers couldn't claim credit?
So as it's getting brighter?
Well, when it was just getting brighter just before it went really blue, what was happening?
So that's basically, that has to do with as the central core of the star is collapsing. And I just realized I forgot to talk about neutrinos. Okay, so the other thing is, because I was talking about the neutrinos, the other thing that was happening then is very important. This is in a few hours, right, before we see that really bright light from the supernova. The star inside has already died. But light takes several hours to reach the surface. If there's stuff there, it has to go out, right? That's just the way it is. So that's sort of that stage we're talking about. Neutrinos don't care, right? Neutrinos just go through any matter. They don't care. So the neutrinos that they detected in 1987 were actually detected about 6 hours before the supernova light was detected. So there's actually supernova neutrino detection systems where, like, the neutrino detectors around the world, you can sign up for the mailing list. And, you know, you'll get an alert. We suddenly saw a ton of neutrinos go out, so maybe you'll see a supernova and become really famous. So you can't do this.
So the gas that surrounds whatever is in the middle, what exactly is it right now? So did Chandra actually know which band of X-ray to look at?
Yeah, so there's different bands of X-ray. I'm showing you three things there. Those are all different bands, so different frequencies of what you're looking at.
So Chandra looked at
So Chandra, they were looking at three different frequencies. So in my own data, we were looking at two bands, and then we averaged them together to make the image, because then we can get a better image. And the small amount we were looking at didn't make a big difference for what we were looking at, basically.
Neutrinos, do they travel at the speed of light, or?
Yeah, so neutrinos travel at faster than light, and that's why we saw them first. They definitely travel at the speed of light, it's just they don't interact with matter and light, you know. So there's both. I mean, you probably wouldn't study this exclusively, especially this time, because, you know, there isn't as much happening as in the first few years. The first few years, there are definitely some PhD theses that came out that were only supernova 1987A. By this point, though, it's kind of like, in February, for example, there was a supernova conference, and then they had a special session just on the supernova that was, like, you know, a morning and a morning conference.
It's always
both in
astronomy.
Yes.
If I've learned anything, that the answer is always both things you think might be happening.
Yeah. And it's always good to diversify in astronomy, right? Because you never know what field's going to pick up and which ones.
Yeah. When you're going to see a supernova in the sky.
Yeah.
Before I let you all go, I have a few more announcements, or rather repetitions of announcements that I made at the beginning. If you sign up for a planetarium show, we now have planetarium ambassadors in the back of the room. We're going to wait. And they will be the ones who are taking you over to your show. There's a meeting point outside, so if you signed up for a show online, then you'll be meeting one of our ambassadors who will take you where you need to be on the map right here. If you still want tickets for a planetarium show, they'll be available outside the room, so directly outside the doors as you leave this talk. I've been informed by a telescope operator that there are gaps in the clouds tonight, so we encourage you to head upstairs to the 14th floor and check out the telescope we have available. We also have a special exhibit tonight by the people who made the system sound video for TRAPPIST-1. It was popular on Facebook, but maybe only for astronomers, because I've talked to a few of you and you haven't heard of it. But there is a guy at UT who has turned the appearance of the TRAPPIST-1 system with seven Earth-like planets in the habitable zone into music. And that will be outside, as well as for other systems that are less exciting than TRAPPIST-1 in my opinion. If you've got questions for us, we'll be here at the front, but otherwise,